Good morning, one and all. So today we'll be seeing you're going into your fifth module, which is your operating system, specifically real-time operating systems. Okay, so this is something that you guys are already learning as part of your OS course, right? Like there are many similar topics. The only thing is we will focus on the real-time aspects of it. Okay, so for this reason, so we will not go in depth of each of these topic, and I mean it's in general that the topics are breadth covered, meaning they're only superficial. They only present overview of the operating system, and again, since there are a lot of overlap between OS and this particular module, I'm not going to again bore you with the same stuff over and over. Okay, I'm just going to focus on the real-time aspects of it. Okay, all right. So we'll start with operating system basics and types of operating systems. So operating system basics, you guys are already aware. Operating system is the interface, or it's the bridge between the user applications and the underlying hardware. Okay. So it manages all the system resources. There are two main functions of the operating system. Okay, the first one is to make all the hardware functionalities user friendly. Okay, for example, if you want to type something and make it display on the screen, it becomes really hard if you want to do everything on a hardware. So you need like a software layer, like an interface. Okay. So that's one of the main reasons why we have operating system. It enables us, it acts as an interface and ease of use for the user. The second purpose of operating system is to manage the system resource efficiently. Okay, so you have lots of hardware. You have your I/O devices, memory, and all these things, hard disk, and a lot of hardware devices are there. Right, so how to manage all these efficiently? So you need operating system again. Okay, so these are the two main functionalities of the operating system. There's something called as API. Okay, so API specifically forms as the interface, or it becomes more as it says, right, application programming interface. It becomes a tool that helps the user to talk to the operating system. Okay. So here's a simple like a cartoon of the API. So here's the user, and here is the actual operating system and the underlying hardware. So API is just the interfacing layer. Okay. So another thing is with your GPS and things like that. So APIs are there in different levels. And when it comes to operating system, you better know these APIs named as system calls. Right, you guys know about system calls, so that's nothing but APIs. Okay, all right. Now going to the core of the operating system, kernel. Right, so you must have heard of what is a kernel. So any operating system will have a kernel, and kernel becomes the core, or it's like the heart of the operating system. Okay, so around this kernel, the kernel is the one that directly talks to the system resources or the hardware. Okay, and it also talks to the user, so it becomes the heart of your operating system. It manages several services like process management, memory management, file management, I/O management, lots of things, protection, everything, right? So there are different services that the kernel handles. Okay, and this is the core. And without a kernel, there is no operating system. So it's like like the most fundamental thing about the operating system. So given there's a kernel, right? So we divide the entire the operating system software framework into two. So one is the kernel space, the other one is user space. Okay, so we know about the user space. User space is all the interfacing things that we see at the top layer, right? At the application layer. So we have all these applications running. So that becomes the user space, and wherever these applications store their data, right? Either it will be in the RAM or it will be in your hard disk. So all these like are part of your user space. Now there are certain things in your that only your operating system should have access to. Okay, so for example, like process management and scheduling, right? So you have to put those process related data somewhere in the memory. and that memory should not be accessible by any user, okay, because he may actually screw things up. So to ensure this, you have something called as a kernel space, okay? So it is dedicated only for the kernel, and it doesn't allow normal users to access it, okay? So based on how the kernel is designed, you can classify kernel into monolithic kernel or micro kernel, okay? So a monolithic kernel is what we have seen, what we see in our daily life, in our PCs and laptops, like your Linux and Windows, where you have a big kernel supporting all the applications and services. Okay, so this kernel, it actually has everything in it. Okay, so the kernel will have a file system, inter-process community, it supports everything. Everything is like integral part of your kernel. Okay, so the good thing is there is one centralized kernel that handles everything. Kernel knows everything about your services. Okay, in contrast, you have something called as a micro kernel, where kernel only handles very, very specific service, like mainly your like security and device drivers, and also like some process scheduling, right? Very, very, very small part of it. And even the device drivers, you don't go for all the device drivers, like a very, very specific thing, only the CPU part or something like that. The advantage of microkernel is that when some service hangs, right? So if you have some kind of a file system crash, or if you have like some device driver getting corrupted, it will affect only that service. It will not affect the entire operating system. But in case of a monolithic kernel, since all the services are part of your kernel here, even if, let's say, your device driver service crashes, then the entire kernel also crashes. That is why we see, like, we've seen your operating system suddenly hanging, right? Your system hangs for no reason. Is it because of all the services collapsing? No, there will be like one particular service that actually crashed, and because of that, the entire kernel is not able to move forward. So the entire kernel also crashed. Okay, so we cannot afford this in our embedded system. Remember, we are doing real-time operating system here that is meant for embedded systems. So we need a reliable operating system here. So even if a device driver or some other service fails, you need only that service to fail, and remaining services should act, okay, should still work. So that's why we generally prefer microkernels in case of real-time operating systems. Okay, so here's the text part of it. Like, again, I'm not going to go through this text. The PPT texts are verbose. Okay, so they're very elaborate for you to go through and then understand them offline. Okay, so I'll just try to explain these things in a very simplified manner. Okay, so microkernels, so they have their own advantage and disadvantage. So it's going to look like this: a monolithic kernel. So all the applications is going to run on like one big kernel. Okay, which has all the services. So the problem is, again, if one of the service fails, the entire operating system crashes. Okay, examples of this includes Linux, Solaris, MS-DOS, Windows, and all these things. Okay, but in the case of microkernels, a microkernel, it only has like very, very basic thing, like memory management, process management, very, very core service. Okay, the other services are offloaded to something called as servers. Okay, so these servers are the ones which takes care of these services. Now, if one of the servers crash, then only that server crashes and the kernel will still function. Okay, so this is helps in actually handling the problem efficiently. There's a graceful degradation here. Okay, so examples of this includes QNX, Minix, and other operating systems. So QNX is a real-time operating system. It's a commercial real-time operating system. And Minix is actually a very nice open source operating system. You know, one of your reference books, Andrew S. Tannenbaum, right? So he's the author of the textbook Operating Systems. So if you refer his textbook, as he started writing the textbook, he started his pet project. He started implementing that operating system as he wrote the textbook. By the end of the time he finished the textbook, he actually had an entire operating system. Okay, so as and when, for every chapter, he used to do a pet project. Okay, so that pet project, he put them all together, and we had Minix. So that's your Minix operating system. It's very, very interesting. Okay. So these are again used in embedded systems. Okay. So here's like the summary of that. Okay. Next, we go to your types of operating systems. So as we have seen, in earlier presentations too, we have something called as general purpose operating system and real time operating systems, right? So general purpose operating system, as the name suggests, it's for general purpose computing systems like your PCs and laptops. Okay, so even your mobile phones have general purpose operating system. They are not RTOS. Okay, RTOS is something that you will see in flight control systems, or you will see in automobile, right? So you have fancy cars like BMW or Audi or something, right? So those have operating systems in it. So they have real-time operating systems. So general purpose operating system, it's again, you don't need a deterministic behavior. You only care about throughput. Good throughput is good, bad throughput is bad, it's okay, fine. But there's no deadline or anything. Okay, like even if there are some random delays and if some application crashes, it only leads to some user satisfaction being lost or user is dissatisfied, right? It doesn't create any other problem. Okay, but in real-time operating system, it's not like that. Okay, so it has to have a deterministic behavior. Like if you want to apply a brake, the brake has to be applied. It cannot go on a crash. Okay, so it cannot afford to not function. Okay, so you need a very reliable operating system here. Okay, so that's why it's always real-time operating systems are deadline driven. You need deadline, so you fix a deadline and you stick to it. Okay, so that's about your RTOS. So also, guys, feel free to stop at any point or put your thoughts in your comment section if you have any questions for me, okay? So I'm just going to go through. I'm just assuming this is a revision session for you because you've already learned all these things in your operating systems class. So I'm just skimming through these topics, okay? So please feel free to put a message if you have any questions, or even over the mic, you can stop me. So real-time operating systems. So we have the following services as part of your real-time operating system. Okay, so the a kernel in the real-time operating system is called as real-time kernel, and the set of services are very similar to your general-purpose operating system. We have task or process management. In this particular textbook, they refer to process as tasks. Okay, so they are interchangeable. Tasks and process are interchangeable. Okay, but here in your textbook they only refer to as task like that. Okay, and then you have your exception handling, memory management, interrupt handling, time management. All these services again are part of your general purpose operating system also, but the way in which they are implemented may change. Okay, the way in which these services are implemented will differ, because these are all deadline driven, but in a general purpose operating system it is not deadline driven. Okay, we have something called as a task control block. Okay, when it comes to your process or task management, a task control block, you would have heard it as process control block, right? It's the same thing. Task control block, it's a data structure to hold all the relevant information about a task or a process. Okay, it has your task ID or process ID, right? So in your Unix, you know the PIDs that you see. So this PID is your task identification number or process identification number. And then you have a task state and task type, task priority, and all these things. So these are all like the attributes of this particular data structure. So these tasks also have pointers to other system resources and also task pointers. If they are dependent on other processes, right? You have pointer to other processes. Okay. So many things are there. So I think you are familiar with this part, right? PCBs or TCBs. So next we have process scheduling. Okay. So now what is a process, first of all? Let's first understand what's a process. So process is nothing but a program in execution. Okay. When you say a program, program is static. You write some code and then that code is just there, right? So it doesn't do anything. It doesn't do anything until it gets executed. So the moment you start executing a program, it becomes a process because it has data, it is task, it's acting, right? So it's actually, it takes an input data, it does some processing, and then it actually works on all the system resources, and it does some useful work. Okay, so that's the process. Process is an active instance of a program. Okay, or in other words, it's a program in execution. Now, when you have multiple processes, you need to have some order where, like, you say, oh, this process should go first. This process you execute first. You wait. So who does all that? The operating system does that. The operating system has something called as a scheduler. Scheduler is again like a service provided by the kernel, and that takes care of your process scheduling. There's something called as process synchronization or task synchronization. So task synchronization is nothing but when you have multiple processes and they need to communicate or they need to synchronize for some reason, right? So you actually have checkpoints and make sure that they actually go in a synchronized manner, okay? And so that you don't face any other any issue. So we'll see more on these later. Okay, and finally, we have exception or error handling. Again, we have lots of errors, right? Error, there is no instance where a process will not have error. You may actually face any kind of error, like you may have divide by zero error, or you may have some timeouts or deadlocks. So many possibilities of you going into unwanted situation, right? So you have this handling. Done. So mostly these handlings are exception handlings are done at the interrupt service level. Then we have memory management. So here is something that is very important that we need to learn with respect to real-time operating system. So in general, like the general purpose operating system, right? So we know how memory is allocated. It's allocated based on, it's called as dynamic memory allocation, right? So what happens is you actually start allocating memory as and when the process requires more memory. Okay, a process requests more memory, so you allocate dynamic memory allocation, right? So you may have mallocs and callocs in the program. So you, as and when as the program executes, you actually start allocating the memory, and then it grows dynamically. But in RTOS, it's that's not the case. Okay, so in RTOS, what happens is that you have limited memory, first of all. And then to actually do a dynamic memory allocation, it actually takes a lot of time. Okay, so especially when you want to have an initialization that needs to be done, then it takes a lot of time to save some time, right? Because you have a fixed deadline to meet. You need a deterministic behavior of these tasks. Okay, so what you do is you actually fix the memory for these processes in advance. Okay, so what we do here is something called as a block allocation. Again, you would have learned this as part of your operating systems course, but you've learned this as one among the several other ways of allocating memory. But here, with respect to operating system, real-time operating systems, this is very important. This is one of the primary ways in which the memory is allocated. Okay, it's called block memory allocation. What you do is you divide the memory into fixed blocks. Okay, and then you determine each process will have their own block of memory. Okay, so you say, okay, this process will have three blocks of memory. This process will have two blocks of memory, like that. Okay, so then once the process executes, finishes execution, then you actually deallocate, like you actually free the memory. The only problem with this is that, let us say you have memory allocation something like this, right? So your A, B, C blocks are fixed, and for some reason, like the process that was holding B actually just left freed the memory. Then what happens if a new process comes and let's say it needs two blocks of memory, then there is a fragmentation here. It will take two consecutive blocks here. Okay, but this part will be fragmented. So this leads to external fragmentation. Okay, so that's one of the major problems with your, just a second. Give me a second. Hello, I'm in class. Hello, I'm in class. I'll call you back. Yeah, okay. Hello. Yeah, sorry guys. So what happens is that you have an external fragmentation here, but still you're okay with this because you know in advance. Let me stop here. Hello, ma'am. I'm in class. Can you please? But I'm in class. I'm not able to call her. I'll call her after 10 o'clock. Sorry, guys. Yeah, but we are still okay with it because there is a deterministic behavior for these processes. So you in advance know that which process is going to precede which process, and then if there's a deterministic behavior, so you can still manage this. Okay, so it's not too much of a problem. Okay, so that's what we are that's why we are sticking to the block-based allocation, because the overhead that we see in block-based allocation is actually lesser than what you will see in dynamic allocation. Okay, so because of that, we still stick to block-based allocation. Okay, so next we have the memory management. So like we saw, right? So this block-based allocation. So we have seen the same thing that has been written here. Okay, and for your information, this is exactly how your flash memory also works, block-based allocation, right? So we saw how your flash memory worked in one of the earlier chapters. So flash memory also works based on block allocations, even though it's not the most efficient one, but it's good enough for us. And then we have our interrupt handling. Okay, so interrupt handling, interrupts we know, right? So interrupts are nothing but as the name suggests, right, like interruption from a regular flow of execution. Like let us say we are executing some process, and then you have some other service that is asking your attention. It's like, oh, that needs CPU's time. Okay, CPU will be executing one process. Okay, and then what happens? Somebody interrupts the CPU and say, hey CPU, there is some urgent thing that you want to do. Like just what happened to me, right? So I've been presenting a class to you, and I just got interrupted. Imagine if I am the CPU, I'm actually doing my job here, and I got interrupted by a phone call. Okay, so that's exactly what happens in the CPU also. But these interrupts can either be synchronous or asynchronous. So what just happened a few minutes back is the asynchronous interrupt. Okay, where I have no control over it. I didn't even expect that will happen. Correct. So that's an asynchronous interrupt. It's not in it's not synchronous to any of the other services. Okay, so it's generally generated by input output devices. Okay, because you don't know when you will press the next key, when you will move the mouse, when you will click the mouse button. Nobody can, CPU cannot predict that, right? So it becomes asynchronous interrupt. Okay, but synchronous interrupts are associated with your processes itself, like software interrupts, right? So what happens is, while execution, you exactly know the moment you do the divide by zero, you are going to be taken to the divide by zero exception handler. Okay, and the moment you always know that you're breaching the memory segment, that moment you will get a segmentation fault. Okay, so you know in advance, it's predictable by the CPU that this interrupt will happen. So those are called as synchronous interrupts. Okay, any questions so far, guys? You're able to follow? Hello. Guys?
Yes, sir, we're able to follow.
Okay, great. Okay. All right. You also have something called as nested interrupts. Okay. Nested interrupts are interrupts being interrupted by something else. Okay. An interrupt being interrupted, and then that interrupt being interrupted. So you have interrupt A being handled, and while the interrupt A is being handled, you get interrupt B. Okay, and then you get interrupt C. then what happens is first interrupt C will get handled, and then you you actually put it in a stack, nothing else, right? Then you your B will get handled, and then A will get handled. Okay, so that's called nested interrupts. And the other one is priorities. Okay, interrupt priorities. So you also have priorities to these interrupts. Let us say you have you actually have interrupt vector table. If you remember, we earlier saw in this chapter, and also you would have seen in operating systems course, that you there is something called as a vector table. Okay, there you have all the interrupts that are supported, and they will have priority. Okay, so what happens is that these interrupts, right? So when two interrupts come together, you will say which is a higher priority interrupt, and you service that first. Okay, so and what happens is there is a preemption also possible. Like for example, you have an interrupt with priority two, priority, I mean the lesser the number, more the priority. Oh my god, really sorry guys. Hello, can you please call at 10 o'clock? I'm in class. Thank you. Too many interrupts. Okay, so yeah, so a higher priority interrupt cannot be interrupted by a lower priority interrupt. Okay, so let us say my priority is priority 2. Okay, now if there is another interrupt coming and it says my priority is 3, no, 3 doesn't work. Okay, you have lesser priority, you go. Okay, high. For all priority works the other way, right? Like you have, it's like rank. Lesser the number, higher the priority. Okay, but when priority 1 comes, it's actually it has higher priority than me. Okay, so I'll be interrupted. Okay, I'll say, oh okay sir, you finish first, then I will continue. Okay, so it's like that. Okay, next we have time management. So we've already seen the hardware implementation of this real-time clock. Now what you have to do is you have to write one API, and then you have to create this interface to get the timer tick. Okay, you need to see the clock, right? So how do you see the clock? You already know how to do the hardware part of it, correct? You use timers, and then you use timers and counters, right? Counters with clocks. So with that you can convert it into seconds, minutes and hours. Okay, you through that you actually create a timer tick. Okay, you create a clock. And that's the math part of it. So how you convert. So based on the length of your timer register, and also the frequency in which you operate, so you can actually calculate the timers time. Okay, so these are the timer ticks. All right, so hard real time system. So this is very, very important. Okay, with respect to real time operating systems, as we have seen, real-time systems have timing constraints. It actually it cannot afford to miss deadlines. So in other words, a late answer is a wrong answer. Okay, so that's all it is. If you push the brake, and if it misses the deadline, it is supposed to take effect within say 100 milliseconds, but it has missed, it has gone to 200 milliseconds. Doesn't matter, right? The braking system cannot say, hey, I still push the brake, I mean, I still, I mean, it still worked. It means it didn't work. It's wrong. That's all. You're dead. There's no argument after that. Okay. So late answer is wrong answer. Okay. Imagine your anti-lock braking system or airbag control. Okay. So these are hard real-time systems. Okay. Missing any deadline may produce catastrophic results. Okay. And also there is something called human in the loop. The moment a human is in the loop, then things are in danger. Okay, you never know how this guy will behave. Okay, you will have unexpected delays. So the moment you have human in the loop, like meaning like you need some kind of human interaction, like typing in a keyboard or any touchpad or something like that, right? So then you have an unpredictable delay, because you don't know when that key will come, because we are now talking in terms of nanoseconds level. Okay, very high clock speed. You need to have at nanoseconds level, 100 milliseconds versus 100 microseconds is going to be 1000 times difference, right? So imagine that. So because of this, you avoid any human in the loop interaction for your hard real-time systems. However, soft real-time systems, you have human interaction, not a problem. For example, ATMs, right? So ATMs will have a constant interaction with the human. Okay, and even there, if you miss the deadline, it is still okay. Okay, so we mean, of course, we have all experienced it. We have even ATMs have gone too far to not even dispense the money, right? It will deduct from our bank account, but then it will not even dispense the money. We are still okay with it. We'll just call the customer service and we will actually take the necessary action. But no catastrophic results are there, right? So it doesn't lead to any catastrophe. No loss of life or damage of product is there. Okay, so these are soft real-time system. The other example is audio playback. Okay, so you may have a very annoying playback system when you have all the deadlines missed, but still it is okay. I mean, you there's no loss of life or any damage created. Okay. Next we come to tasks. Tasks are also a task. Again, it's interchangeable. It's called as job. It's called as process. They're all interchangeable. Okay, it's nothing but program in execution. Okay, so now this process, when it is created as you can imagine it to be like an object. Okay, object of a program. Okay, if you imagine your program to be like a class, your process is nothing but the object. Okay, it's a running instance. So what happens is you have all these associated with your process. When the moment a process is created, okay, what does a process need? You have your code, right? So that code has to be somewhere. So that is your code memory. Okay, that process will point to the code memory through your PC. Okay, and then you have to hold all the variables, right, somewhere in the registers, and you need to know which register is holding what value. Okay, so that you need a working copy of all the registers, not only your data registers but also your status registers. You also need stack pointer because you need to keep track of the functions. Okay, how the functions are being called. So which function should I return to? Okay, all these things should also be part of your process. Okay, so this is nothing but a running instance of your program. Now we talked about the memory, right? So you have code memory that has the code, whatever .c or .py, whatever you're writing, right? Whichever source code you're writing. So that memory, that goes into the code memory. Now we are talking about the primary memory. I'm not saying which folder you have saved your program. Not that. We are not talking about that. The moment you call the program, right? You do .a.out. The moment you do the .a.out, that a.out will actually be loaded to one part of your memory, correct? It will go to the primary memory somewhere. And that is your code memory. Okay, don't confuse it with the location where it is saved in your hard disk. That's not the one we are talking about here. This code memory is nothing but your .a.out that gets loaded the moment you hit your .a.out. Okay, the moment you start executing, you actually first thing you do is you take that a.out file and put it in your primary memory. Okay, and then you have all the data memory. This data memory is nothing but all the global variables, and it grows the other way. So it's also called as heap memory. And the other one is the stack memory that holds the local variables. So stack grows from up towards down. Okay, and the heap grows from down towards up. Okay, so otherwise it's just the way it goes. Both actually work like a stack only. Okay, so the data structure is like that, but one grows upwards, the other grows downwards. Now this is a very important figure. Okay, this is the life cycle of a process. Okay, the process will first get created. The moment you do .a.out, the process will get created. Okay, and it will have its associated PID and the entire process block, right? The task control block, it will get created, and it will have all the data structures fields in it, like PC, your status register, data register, stack, heap, everything will get created. Okay, so that instance of your process is created now. Then what will happen is, once all these things are created, it goes to a ready queue. Okay, there is a queue, a FIFO queue that where the process places itself ready to get scheduled. It's ready for execution now. It has everything because I have all the data with me. I have all the resources known to me what I require. So I'm ready to get executed. Then the scheduler comes into picture. The scheduler will say, now I see so many of you sitting in the FIFO queue. Now I select you. You go run. Okay. Scheduler will select one of the processes from the ready queue, and then it will allocate it to run at a time. If you have a single processor system, right? If you have only one CPU, at any given time there is only one process that will run. Okay, not more than one process will run. So that will be running. Okay, and then if it's a very simple and a small process, it will finish running and then it will go to the completed state, end of lifetime of that process. The process is done. However, it may not be that simple. Okay, what might happen is that you may actually wait for some IO. Okay, so let us say you're writing a program where you get input from the user. Okay, please enter the input number of elements in the array. Then you wait. What happens that you mean the process has to wait, right, for you to enter the number. Until then it will go to the blocked state. It doesn't know when it gets that input from you. Okay, so it will go to a blocked state. Okay, so that it frees the CPU and some other process can run in that time. Okay, so to allocate this process will go to blocked state, and once the IO is done, right, then it goes to ready queue again. Okay, and it has to wait for the CPU to get reallocated. Okay, there is another instance where it gets preempted. Okay, so in this case it's actually preemption by another process. What happens here is that I'm running this process in the CPU, so I'm actually running, and then what happens is some higher priority guy comes and says, hey, come on, get out, I have higher priority, I need to run. Okay, so he's a huge guy, a big process, very important, and then very influential, so I don't want to mess with him. So I get preempted and then I go back to my queue. Okay, I just shut my mouth and go back to queue. Okay, that higher priority process will finish, and then at some point my scheduler will reschedule me again. Okay, the other way is in your scheduling itself, there is a way everybody will get 10 timestamps. Okay, so I will finish my 10th timestamp 10, and then I will go back. Okay, like a nice guy, I will just go back, like a round robin scheduling if you take, right? So you automatically get preempted by yourself. You say I will only run for 10 milliseconds and then I will go back. Okay, something like that. Okay, so this is your process life cycle. Okay, process states and transition. Okay, so these are the explanation of that. Any questions so far? Is it clear, guys?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you guys are familiar with all these things, right? I am just superficially going through this. You guys have learned all these things in operating systems? Hello? Hello, guys?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Threads. So, next topic is threads. Okay. So, what is a thread? Everybody says a lightweight process is thread. What is meant by lightweight process? Yes, thread is also known as lightweight process. Why is it lightweight? Is it like I have a big process, let us call it 100, right? Is thread I can divide that entire 100 into like 10 instances? Not exactly, but something very similar. Okay, so instead of going through these texts, right, I will just explain you what thread is with this picture. What happens is, you have something called as a process. Process is like a monster. It's a big entity. Okay, it's a huge program that has to get executed. Now, what is happening is that there are several interdependencies within the program itself. Okay, and there's a lot of independent stuff also in the program itself. Okay, now you can exploit the independent part of it. And you don't have to get penalized for like one particular thing that you need to wait. For example, I'll tell you an example. Like we just spoke about getting an input from a user, correct? That is an IO operation. Now, let us say there are other independent tasks or functions that are there in that same program. That is independent of your user input, you have to execute it in any way, okay? Let us say one part of the program is waiting for user input, but there are other parts of program that doesn't need that input. It can run right independently. So that is what led to the concept of threads. So here what happens is, you still have a single code memory. Okay, you are not dividing the entire process into if you have n as your process, n by number of threads is not every thread. Okay, you do have like lot of common data and things to share. For example, your code, there is only one code. Even if you have multiple threads, all these threads will have the same code. Okay, the same code. It is only different sections it will execute. One thread will execute one part of the code. The other thread will execute other part of the code. But the entire code, there is only one instance of your code in your memory. Okay. Similarly, data memory, the heap that we talked about, right? All the global variables. All the global variables are shared among all these threads. Okay. So these two are common across all these threads. Now, what is different is that every thread will have its own instance of its register and its stack. Stack is nothing but local variable. Whatever variable locally this thread has, it will not be shared to the other threads. Okay. Only this thread has. It makes sense, right? So it's like you can something like a function, right? Inside a function, if you have any local variable, it's only local to that function. Similarly, this thread also, whatever local variable is there in this thread, that is accessible only to this thread. Others cannot access it, but not for global. Global variable is for across, shared across. And similarly, the registers also. Now, because of this, right? So when we have some child thread that is independent of the other child, then these two can run parallelly. Okay, meaning if one is waiting for IO, the other one can still proceed. So this will actually make the throughput better. Okay, so that's the concept of multi-threading. Okay, so there are POSIX threads, Win32 or Windows threads, and there are also Java threads. Okay, so you can actually take a look at it offline. So I'm just going to explain you a couple of more concepts in threading. One is, there are two types of threads, okay, user level thread and kernel level thread. So user level thread is, as the name suggests, it's at the user level, okay, and the kernel level thread is the one that's supported by the kernel. When we say kernel level thread, right, so let's go back to this particular figure. Now, you need the kernel to understand that this is an entire process and that every thread has to have its own stack and its own registers. Okay, let us say you are supporting three threads like shown in this figure. Okay, now your operating system has to have three separate instances of stack and three separate instances of registers. Correct? Now, only if your operating system has this data structure in this fashion, okay, you have a common code, common data, and individual stack and registers, three instances of these for one for each thread. Then if you have that support, then it means that you have kernel thread support. Okay, otherwise you don't have a kernel thread support. Even though you have multi-threaded application written in your high-level language, it will only be a user thread and your kernel will see everything as a single thread or a single process. So here, based on this, you have a different mapping, okay, many to one model, where you have multiple threads, right? So you have many threads at the user level, but when it comes to scheduling, a kernel thread will still see this as one process. Okay, all these things belong to one process, or in other words, one thread only. Okay, so there is no real exploit or there is no real usage of threads at the hardware level. Okay, however, when you have this different data structures, like you have the separate stack and all these things, support in the operating system, then you have something called as kernel threads, multiple kernel threads. Then what you can do is you can associate each user thread to one kernel thread. Okay, so this becomes a one-to-one model. What we saw earlier is many-to-one model. Even though you have many threads in the user level, everything will be seen as a single thread from your kernel. Okay, there's no real use of threads here. But in one-to-one model, you map every single user thread to one single kernel thread. Okay, again, the problem is it's not flexible. Okay, let us say this particular thread is waiting for IO. So then this kernel thread cannot proceed. What if there is another process and that another process can execute? Okay, so because of this, you come to some many-to-many model. where you have multiple kernel threads that can be mapped to multiple user threads. Okay, so this is the most advanced mapping in the multi-threaded model. Okay, so thread versus process, you have these are the differences. So thread is a single unit of execution and it's part of the process. Okay, process is more like a process will contain, it's a superset of these threads. Okay, so we've seen all these differences. So like we said, right, it shares the memory, it doesn't have its own data memory, but process will have its own data memory. Okay, so let's not go into all these details. So I've already explained this in the previous slides. Okay, we have another 10 minutes, so we'll just quickly go through this multiprocessing and multitasking. Okay, when you say multiprocessing, it means that you have multiple CPUs, like your octa-core CPU you have in your cell phone, right? So you have a multiprocessing system. But do you need always multiple processes? Even before the invention of multiprocessing or multi-core processors, we did have multitasking. Okay, we still had your operating system work efficiently. How did we do that? We did that using multi-programming and multitasking. Okay, I'll first explain what is multitasking. Multitasking is also called as time sharing, where you get a feeling, the user gets a feeling that your operating system is doing multiple tasks at the same time. Okay, but in the background, it is doing a time sharing. In other words, I'm doing this presentation here, right? The operating system takes its time, it allocates like a fixed time for this presentation to get displayed on the screen. And at the same time, in another window, I can still type my Word document. Operating system will actually give another time for that particular Word document to get typed. Okay, so this will happen in a time shared manner. At a time, remember the process diagram that we saw? At a time, only one process will get executed in one CPU. Okay, but it happens so fast that your eyes is not able to perceive, the human is not able to perceive this switching happening so fast. You see, you think that, oh, okay, everything is happening parallelly, wow, great, but it is not. In effect, at a time only one process is being scheduled, it is just happening very fast. This is called as multitasking. Okay, and when you say multi-programming, it means that in your memory, it's kind of the same thing at a finer granular level. Okay, multitasking at a finer granular level is multi-programming, where in one memory, right, if you have a primary memory, that primary memory supports loading of multiple executables in the code section. Okay, you can load lots of your A dot outs, okay, lots of your executables into, you can load more than one program into your memory at a given time. So that is called as multi-programming. Okay, and how this happens? It happens based on your context saving and context switching, right? You save, you switch, and then when you come back, you do context retrieval. So when you do this so fast that you think that things are all happening parallelly. Okay, so here, so context switching runs like this, right? The process one is running and then process two is idle. So this is waiting in ready queue. So you actually say, oh, okay, process two, let me you run before process one continues. And then after it finishes, then process one will start. Okay, it will continue from the exact moment where it left. You have to save all your registers, your link register, your program counter, your all your local registers, everything. And then you need, when you come back, you actually retrieve it. If you remember, we did that using load multiple and stored multiple in module 2. Now we are talking about multitasking, right? Multitasking, there are different types of multitasking. One is cooperative multitasking. Here, what happens is, it's actually kind of a cruel system here. Okay, you allocate some process to run and others should just wait. We will just wait, oh, when this will finish. And that particular process that is running, right, after it finishes everything and it feels like, ah, now I will leave CPU. Okay, now I don't need CPU. Okay, I'm done with it. Then everyone, you all go. Okay, it voluntarily relinquishes the CPU. Okay, if the current CPU, current process is current task is not cooperative, then the entire system will go for a toss. Okay, everybody is going to starve. The other one is preemptive multitasking. Previously, we did that, and then not all processes are very nice, so we suffered. Okay, so then we got into this preemptive multitasking, where we have the CPUs will say, okay, operating system will say, enough, you've done so much, then time for you to stop, and then let the other process continue. Okay, you preempt the process. There is also an alternative called non-preemptive multitasking, where it is allowed, right? So especially if it's a high priority task, you don't want it to be preempted. So you say, okay, non-preemptive. You start executing, you finish it. Okay, so it really depends on the scheduler how you schedule this. Okay, so how many slides more? We will just stop with this. Okay, task communication. So I'll just give you a summary of this, and then we will stop for the day. Okay, task communication. So we have tasks communication. Okay, when you have multiple processes, all these tasks or processes need to communicate. Okay, so these are either cooperating processes or competing processes. The communication happens like that. Okay, so the cooperating processes are nothing but it require some cooperation from the other process. This cooperation may be data. Okay, I need your data, please share. So that is one type of cooperation. The other one is, I don't need data, but I just want to make sure we are in sync. So this is something like, you have your audio data and video data, correct? Both audio and video should synchronize. There's no data exchange between these two. Okay, it's only a matter of synchronization. The other one is competing process. Now here, there is no data sharing or anything. These processes need the same resource. For example, I also need a microphone, while the other process also needs the microphone. Okay, both are competing for this one microphone. Okay, only one will get it, correct? Or a printer, for example. If you want to print something, whoever gets it first will get the printer, right? So something like that. So that is the competing process. Okay, so with this, we will stop for the day. Okay, so next class, we will see inter-process communication. Okay, thanks guys. You can give your attendance and feel free to leave. Thanks.